2NURFM, a broadcast service of the University of Newcastle.
And time to have a look at the ever-exciting, effervescent world of politics. Jim Jost, good morning. It is exciting, isn't it?
Yes, good morning, Mark. It certainly is. Yeah. There's always something exciting to look at.
Well, look, this week we're going to have a look at the framework around evidence-based policy, and we're going to take a step back from that to start with, because there is a topic that gets a lot of emotion, and it was brought out again recently, the idea of drug testing those on certain Centrelink benefits. And most people are on board with it, saying, yeah, it's a great idea. You know, if you're on the dole, you can't afford to be out taking drugs or whatever, because we're paying for it. But we want to take a step back from that this morning, don't we, to start
with? Well, I guess the rationale for these sorts of policies is, at a superficial level, it's all about, well, we're using taxpayers' funds to provide a support or a benefit, and therefore, if a recipient of that spends it on alcohol, drugs, or tobacco, or whatever, they're sort of wasting that money, and they're sort of draining even further the taxpayer's dollar. But I think we need to sort of step back from that. And I mean, it's also sometimes posited as, you know, this is a way of assisting people to spend their money wisely and helping with the drug problem, getting the cleaning up the drug problem. But if we look back at that a little bit, one, it's based on more a judgmental process where we cast negative judgments on people receiving benefits, and we assume that they're not entitled to them anyway. They get them under sufferance, and we do everything we can within policy context to ensure that only the deserving, only the appropriate people get the benefits. So therefore, if they've got a benefit, they have an obligation to spend it wisely, and in particular to go out looking for work or whatever the case may be. Mark, that the level of the dole is way below what people need to have even a modest living is one thing. But if we come back to the sort of drug testing issue, there's a moral judgment being made there, because there are numerous areas where people who are in receipt of taxpayers' money aren't ever going to be tested, you know, politicians for one thing. And I think that the logic that's being applied, in the first instance, the logic that's being applied is that, well, you know, if you have a certain job and you're under the influence of certain substances or alcohol, you can't do the job properly, and therefore you shouldn't be doing the job. But receiving a welfare benefit is not necessarily doing a job, and it's not putting anyone at risk. There are issues around the unfortunate and terrible side effects of drug abuse and so forth, but that problem is not going to be solved by making it harder for people to survive, making it taking them off the dole or taking them off a benefit because they've tested positive for a particular drug.
We actually had this as a topic on our Facebook page last week, when they were sort of throwing feelers out that the announcement's coming, and as they do from time to time. I couldn't find, and I haven't gone back through the comments this morning from last week, but I couldn't find anybody that was actually not in support of this approach being taken, with the thought being that, yes, you are getting the benefit, but hang on a minute, if we're paying for that benefit, simply if you can't afford to be working, if you can't afford to feed yourself, because we know the Centrelink payments are very low, and that's another argument that possibly should be made for lifting them. But if you can't afford to feed your family, if you can't afford to send the kids to school and new clothes, you certainly can't afford to be out the back on drugs all day. That's the general vibe that we get every time this comes up.
Well, certainly. I mean, one can see the logic of that. But then once you take people off the benefits as a punishment for not complying or for falling foul of this new approach, then you actually worsen their situation and make it near on impossible for them to survive in a even halfway reasonable place. So you compound the problem as a solution. And what that compounding reveals is more a punishment process, a punishing attitude and approach to assisting people. For example, let me just take an example where the evidence suggests, say in Cabramatta, where there was a huge, and maybe still is, some pockets of drug problems there, but compared to where it was 3 or 4 years ago, where there was a huge problem, through a combination of both public support, of supporting people in need, of education, a degree of policing, a combination in which various community organisations were able to provide the support that was needed, instead of punishing people who are in trouble and needing to get off drugs, they put in place programs and methods that enabled people to slowly improve, and the situation has radically improved compared to where it was 3 or 4 years ago.
Would it be a sensible ploy to say, well, if this is coming, if we are going to move down this road, we need to have all the other things in place, like rehab opportunities and just ways for people to quote-unquote get clean, knowing that, well, most of your money, you're not going to have that option to spend in this area?
Well, certainly all of those sorts of things have to be in place, but removing people from a source of income to pay for other things is not going to solve that problem. It's going to lead to compounding the problem and only keeping people trapped in those cycles of poverty rather than enabling them to get out. And on top of that, Mark, we also have to have a more concerted job creation process and not just simply assert that you should be getting a job and go out there and get a job.
Well, it can be very tough.
First of all, we need to have the jobs in the places where people are living so that they can actually get themselves out of cycles of poverty. But we need to really stop sort of adopting a punishing approach and sort of look at the evidence around which successes can be made and then perhaps follow that. But we've had successive governments, and it's on both sides of the parliamentary divide where the political parties have been much more prepared to take a punishing approach, because oddly enough, people seem to like that when it comes to elections. It means that the politicians who are advocating those tough lines are somehow or other doing a better job than politicians who advocate, you know, we've got to find ways to fix the problem and support people rather than punish them.
And just on the jobs very quickly, sadly, over the last few decades as well, we've removed so many levels of jobs that people can take. But I guess that's another argument for another day. Jim, thanks for sharing a bit of that with us this morning, as always.
My pleasure, Mark.
Jim Jost, The World of Politics. He'll be doing it again with us next week at 2NURFM 103.7.